Ladies and gentlemen, you've been listening to the Gustavus Brass Choir under the direction of D. Scott Moore. As we get ready for our final talk of this session, I'd like to repeat what I said once again about our final talk this evening. Dr. DeDuve's talk will be given in the banquet room, but for those of you who do not have a ticket, we will be broadcasting the address in Alumni Hall. This is the same room that we used last night for the Q&A sessions on science and religion. It's in the upper floor of the Johnson Student Union building, which is over that way from here. Okay. And I would suggest that you arrive somewhere between 7:30 and 7:45 to get a seat then. Okay. And at this point, it's my privilege to introduce my colleague, Pam Kittleson from our Department of Biology, who will introduce our speaker, Sean Carroll from the University of Wisconsin.
Dr. Sean Carroll grew up in an industrial city in Middle America that he has described as practically devoid of beauty and nature. Nonetheless, he found inspiration to study biology in the intricate, repeated color pattern of his pet snakes. After obtaining his PhD at the age of 22, Sean has gone on to help shape a relatively new subdiscipline of biology that is called Evo-Devo, which is not what my brother mistakenly identified as a reincarnation of an 80s rock band. But Evo-Devo is a term for evolutionary development. One puzzle has particularly intrigued Sean. Even though all organisms on Earth share or have evolved from a common ancestor, when we examine the outward appearance of animals, they show incredible variety in form and function. So he has wanted to better understand what are the underlying mechanisms that make animals look so vastly different from one another. Does the whole genome need to be rearranged in order to make a zebra? And then again to make a fly, and then again to make a human? Or might these organisms share the same general genome? And instead, do simple changes in genes and regulatory circuits alter development of the embryo such that different sizes, shapes, and functions result? His innovative approaches in linking development with evolutionary biology at several levels has led to many awards. Notably, he was named by Time magazine as one of the top 50 leaders under the age of 40 and was awarded a National Science Foundation Presidential Young Investigator Award. Currently, he is an investigator for the Howard Hughes Medical Institute at the University of Wisconsin. From the large-scale changes that distinguish major animal groups to the finely detailed color pattern on butterfly wings, Dr. Carroll's research has centered on genes that can create a blueprint for body plans. He has helped elucidate how these genes may play large roles in the origin of new developmental pathways and ultimately in explaining the widely different forms of animals that we see today. Please join me in acknowledging Dr. Carroll for his contributions to our understanding of another piece of the puzzle that is the story of life.
Thank you very much, Pam. And thank you to the band, which is assembled somewhere else at the moment. I'll have something for you guys later. Thank you to the organizers, the faculty hosts, the student hosts. I think I speak on behalf of the whole panel that this has been an incredible experience for the scientists who've been invited here. If you told me that this symposium would draw a few hundred people, I'd be so delighted and surprised. The fact that it draws more than 5,000 is mind-boggling to us, and it's an inspiration for us to take away. having visited Gustavus and gotten such a great reception from all of you. So thank you for hanging in there and for your great enthusiasm about all this science. So I have a little different story than the rock stars of today, but the inspiration is the same. Most of us biologists, we are first inspired by our contacts with the natural world, and we have the same awe and wonder that all of you have at tropical reefs and rainforests, or simply enjoying a deer hopping through the backyard. My point of attack, though, is different than the other speakers, and I'm going to ask questions about really sort of the internal processes. There's a French physicist, Jean Perrin, a Nobel Prize winner, said quite a long time ago that for science, the quest is always the same. It's to explain the complex visible by some simple invisible. And that's one of my goals today, is to take something that may seem at first glance complicated, almost a little daunting, and boil it down to some simple, elegant, maybe you might even see some beautiful mechanisms. And also to actually make those beautiful mechanisms visible. So I hope for some of you, you're going to see some things you haven't ever seen before. And once you peer into that world, it will change the way you look at nature, the way you look at animal form, and the way in your own mind you perceive the process of evolution. The two major questions I'm going to focus on today are closely related. But they sort of serve as the front half and the back half of my talk. How do individual animal forms develop? And how have so many different animal forms evolved? These are two of the oldest questions in biology. They've been thought about for a very long time. But until recently, answers were just not forthcoming. We really didn't have a picture of what goes on inside the black box of the embryo that creates the sizes and shapes and things that we all marvel at. And we certainly didn't understand how the diversity of forms that have been on parade for the last 2 days came into being from the viewpoint of the sculpting process of development. The answers have been forthcoming in bunches recently. And the answers have been many of them have been so entirely unexpected that it's revolutionized our view of the animal kingdom, the making of the animal kingdom, and our place in it. And maybe the first take-home message I'll give you is that despite the enormous diversity that we perceive, the diversities of form, there are some basic things that all animals share deep down at the genetic level that is the most fantastic evidence for Darwin's, one of his most powerful ideas of descent from a common ancestor, certainly in the case of the animals. And the discovery of these commonalities between animals has opened up a whole new way of studying both living animals and the past to get insights into how this diversity evolved. I'm going to tell you about these discoveries and their implications, and I first want you to appreciate a little bit more about the relationship between these two processes that we call development and evolution. So development, you've all been through it. Many of you have created the next generation yourselves. Development is the process that transforms an egg into an adult. It's also the study of development is referred to as embryology. And the way I want you to think about evolution for my talk, and I'm really speaking about the evolution of form, and particularly the evolution of form on the scale that Dr. Eldridge, Dr. Curry, Dr. White spoke about, really large-scale changes that we can see happening over substantial periods of time, for example, in the fossil record. And we're going to think about the evolution of form. But the simplest way to think about the evolution of form is that it's occurring through changes in development. Development is the process that builds an animal. It's the changes in that process of building that leads to the evolution of new forms, that actually creates those new forms. So there's a very close relationship between these two processes. The trick for biologists has been that we didn't know anything much about development until perhaps the last 20 years, and therefore we didn't have much insight into the actual mechanisms governing the evolution of form. This relationship has been appreciated for a very long time, and again, T.H. Huxley comes up in part of our lore. And the relationship between evolution and development was appreciated by Darwin, by Huxley, right off the bat. And in fact, they tried to use that to help people in general appreciate the process of evolution by bringing it really into contact with something that we had already everyday experience in. We all take as a given that complexity, the building of a complex animal from a single cell is something that goes on all the time, whether it takes a day or a week or a month or 9 months, whatever it may be. And so Huxley points out that as a natural process of the same character as the development of a tree from its seed or a fowl from its egg, that evolution excludes creation and all other kinds of supernatural intervention. Just imagine this process being modified in small and subtle ways over vast periods of time, and you see you have a window into understanding how different forms have evolved. Now, I said that it took a long time to make progress here, and you might want to wonder about what those reasons may be. And maybe I think it would be productive to first sort of address maybe some of the challenges that are before us, as well as some preconceptions that certainly biologists had and maybe shared more widely. Could this process just be hopelessly complex that we couldn't understand it? How could one cell turn into perhaps 10 trillion cells organized into tissues and organs of the body? It's certainly magnificent. And if you ever watch an embryo develop, whether that's a fly embryo or a frog embryo, or if you've seen the video footage of human embryos in utero developing, there's no one who's untouched by watching that process as at just being awestruck by the development of order from what appears to be no order. Another challenge is that different animals would have different rules. So to understand the animal kingdom, we'd have to study everything in enormous amounts of detail. And my goodness, there's just not enough people and money in the world to do that. And if you think about genes, and we're going to talk about genes today, you might have some notions about genes. Obviously, genes and genetics and genomes are all over the news. And there are many ideas that have been kicking around biology about the relationship between genes and the evolution of form. For example, would the evolution of new animals and parts, would that involve the require the evolution of new genes? So you might imagine then that, you know, humans would have more genes than other animals, because after all, you know, we've got more stuff. We're doing more things, certainly up here. And what's the relationship between genes and our anatomy? Is there a gene for every piece of anatomy and trait? Is there a gene for every finger, every toe, every muscle, every rib, for speech, etc.? And so, you know, should we imagine what evolution has done is keep adding these characters, adding these traits, sort of by adding the genes for building them? Or is the reality somewhat different? And what is that reality? And that's what we're going to focus on. So for today, I want to divide the talk into these two halves. And I'm going to spend a fair amount of time getting you hopefully a little bit more comfortable, maybe a process you haven't thought much about, but hopefully by visualizing it in the way that I'm going to show you, that you'll appreciate what's going on in that little universe of a developing embryo. And we're going to talk about the making of animals. And I'm going to focus on common features of animal design. I want to give you a way of thinking about animal architecture that boils down what would otherwise perhaps be bewildering diversity into some basic principles, some basic design principles, architectural principles. And then I'm going to talk about how we found some of the big guns, the genes that matter the most to the form of animals, but how we got there by first studying monsters, and how these monsters led us to the discovery of these master genes that involved in building our bodies and body parts. I'm going to talk about that process of building animals, because it's my strong conviction that once you've gotten a window into that process, you can start to see, aha, if this is the way it works for this particular species, all I have to do is change things a little bit here, and I'm going to get a different product from this process. I'm going to get an animal that looks different. So we need a window in on development. We need to see things happening in real time to appreciate how diversity evolves. And one of the major messages of the first half of this talk, and the framework to hang the rest of the talk on, is the discovery of a genetic, so-called genetic toolkit for animal development that's widely shared in the animal kingdom. One of the biggest surprises to come out of biology in the last 20 years. Okay, so let's start off talking, and then in the second part of the talk, we'll talk explicitly about the making of diversity, and I'll hopefully mention a few of what might be your favorite animals. They're some of my favorites. So let's talk first about some common features of animal design and get everybody on the same page. If you think about some of the most abundant, large, complex animals, including ourselves, one of the basic architectural principles is that they're built of building blocks, or of, we could call those modules, or repeating parts, and that there's a number of these repeating parts, and these various repeating parts are specialized for particular functions. So if you look at something like a snake, it's really obvious. Look down the backbone of a snake, and you see these hundreds of vertebrae, all with ribs projecting out of them. If you look at our backbone, and you understand that we're built up of these repeating parts, these vertebrae, some of these vertebrae have ribs coming off of them, some do not. If you have carefully dissected a lobster, maybe it's one of your favorite things to do, it is mine, that if you've appreciated particularly, you can maybe tell from this top-down view, you see its claws and its legs and its tail, etc. But if you were to turn that lobster over, you'd see that on each repeating segment of the animal, there's all sorts of, well, just for the moment, bells and whistles projecting off that body that serve various functions. The claws for grabbing, the antennae for sensing, legs for walking, swimmerettes for swimming, or for actually helping the female discharge its eggs. So really, a lot of animals are assembled almost, if you remember the child's toy that's sort of the pull-along caterpillar made up of these little blocks. And what you have in this repetitive design is you've created a larger animal, and the specialization of these individual parts allows a lot of functional diversification among those animals. Furthermore, when you look at body parts, like our hand, it itself is made up of modular parts, of repeating bits. For example, our digits. If you look at other sorts of animals like butterflies, there's two themes of repetition you can see here. The fore wings and the hind wings in this butterfly are very similar, and wings are types of these repeating parts. And within the wings, if you actually look carefully at the patterns themselves are serial repetitions of a basic pattern, sometimes with a little bit of modification between each subdivision of the wing. So this architectural principle, the construction of animals by repeating parts, of vertebrates, of arthropods, even things like annelids, marine worms, earthworms, that sort of thing, this seems to be a general feature of animal architecture. And is that modularity, is that construction from building blocks, is it important? Well, these two groups have adapted to every environment on Earth, air, water, and land. They're among the most abundant species, both in terms of number and biomass. So from my point of view, absolutely. This sort of modular design is really important to their adaptive success. And as you heard earlier, various types of evolved wings, not just, of course, in the vertebrates, birds, pterosaurs, bats, but of course in insects. Insects, for example, constituting 75% of all known animal species on the face of the earth. So the ability to be larger, more complex, and to diversify these repeating parts has been very important. Obviously, a lot of our parts are diversified in specialized ways, and it's been really important. In fact, it allows me to talk to you and to click the button at the same time. Although not many scientists, perhaps you know, can do that, talk and click a button at the same time. This principle of making bodies of repeating parts or parts of themselves repeating parts, we refer to these body parts, and it's a term that I'll use a few times in the talk, as serial homologs. The idea is it's the same part serially reiterated, not necessarily in the exact same form. So, for example, vertebrae are serial homologs. Insect segments are serial homologs. All the limbs on an insect, including its antennae and mouth parts, are serial homologs. Its forewings and hindwings are serial homologs. And this general aspect of design has been around a long time. If you look at some of the first large complex animals, forerunners of most modern phyla, these are the famous fossils of the Burgess Shale, the first evidence of the Cambrian explosion discovered almost 100 years ago. And if you look at these animals, maybe if we just focus here on this trilobite, which you've seen before, and an animal that most everyone has some familiarity with, look at this trilobite's design. Serially reiterated parts with very similar anatomy, but a little bit of change perhaps in size and shape as you go from the front to the back of the animal. Here's an ancient animal, actually belongs to a sister group to the arthropods, called the Lobopodians or Onocophora, and you see its limbs, which are not very fancy, they're just tube-like appendages with no joints, they're serially reiterated down the main body axis and not at all differentiated from each other. So this pattern in evolution has been around a long time of this construction of animals from serially reiterated parts. But if you look at some of the other Cambrian animals, you can see that those serially reiterated parts have been differentiated from each other. They've become specialized. So in something like this primitive crustacean, you see that there are walking legs that are jointed, and those are different than the appendages that stick off of its head. So this building block, this sort of child's toy design of making things of repeating blocks and then having the freedom, it appears, from the evolution, from the fossil record, to make different specializations of those building blocks is a very, very important general feature in animal design. And since it characterizes some of the most important groups that interest us all, it's really what I'm going to focus on for the course of this talk. Now, this pattern is so evident that the paleontologist Samuel Williston in 1914 actually coined a law. Now, laws in biology they're rarely articulated and therefore almost certain, largely because they're almost certain to be broken by some organisms. But I want you to think of Williston's law just sort of as a framework to think about these trends I'm going to talk about in the course of my lecture. And what Williston noted, he was studying animals like this, these reptiles, that had serially reiterated body patterns. You can see, like, for example, these really long tails were really, you just see the vertebrae getting smaller and smaller and smaller as you progress towards the tail. But other than that, not a whole lot of differentiation down there. But what Williston was noting or codifying was that it seemed to be a general trend in evolution that from some primitive state where you had lots of serially reiterated parts of the same kind, that those parts tended toward reduction in number with the fewer parts becoming greatly specialized in function. And that's a trend that we can see in arthropods. It's a trend that we can see in vertebrates. The building blocks becoming specialized and becoming reduced in number. So with those trends as a backdrop, what we'd really like to understand is if one of the major trends in evolution is changes in the number and kind of body parts, how do you make those body parts in the first place? Then how can you modify them between taxa to get these diversity of body designs? So how do we get into this? Well, obviously the fossils, they're our framework for thinking about this, but we can't work on these fossils from a viewpoint of embryology. We need examples that we can work on in the lab. And the beginning of the breakthrough into this puzzle of animal architecture was the discovery of mutants that affect animal architecture in very discrete ways. Namely, they affect the number or the placement of body parts. And these are pretty spectacular. Let me show you some examples. So we're going to talk a lot about fruit flies. And for those of you who are biased that fruit flies just aren't worth your afternoon, I hope within 20 minutes I've shattered that notion forever. So here's a normal fruit fly. It has one pair of wings and it has these specialized appendages in the back that help it steer while it's flying. And this fruit fly is pretty different. And this fruit fly is due to a discrete set of mutations at one gene that cause a second pair of wings to form behind this first pair of wings. So here's a case where you have the wrong number of parts. Now, it may be a little more subtle when you look down at this fruit fly, but look carefully at its head. Okay? Those are not antennae. In fact, the antennae are so fine on these fruit flies that at this magnification you can barely see them. Those are legs coming out of its head. That's not the normal situation. So this fruit fly with legs coming out of its head, that's a good body part. It's not just that you've failed to form something. You formed something. That's a really good leg, but you've put it in the wrong place. Okay? So some instruction has gone awry here. And it was the study of these mutants, eventually, in a way that I'm going to unfold for you in the next few minutes, that really changed our view of animal diversity. because it led us to some genes that told us an awful lot about the general logic of animal development. So these are two cases I'm showing you in adult animals of changing the number or kind of body parts. I just want to show you one more case because, or one more set of cases, because these flies are alive, okay? Now, they wouldn't do so well in the wild, but we keep them in bottles in the lab, and even though this fly has legs coming out of its head, it doesn't give them any kind of complex about it. All the other flies in the bottle look the same. So they continue to mate, and they don't hold it against each other whatsoever. But they wouldn't do that well in the wild, and we can talk about that maybe at the end. But they're very, very helpful to geneticists to finding out some clues of the basic logic of how you put together an animal body. There are other mutations that you could appreciate that are so dramatic that they kill the animal. They kill the embryo when it's developing. But they don't just leave a completely unformed animal. They leave an animal whose deformities or whose abnormalities are very discrete, and again, really important clues to us about the logic of animal design. And here's some examples here. What this is really a tracing of sort of the skeleton, which is not an internal skeleton, but an external skeleton, of a fruit fly larva, a one-day larva. And it has these repeating patterns which actually reflect the formation of segments. And what geneticists have found are all sorts of genes, a relatively small number, but a variety, that when mutated either cause fusions of all of these segments, or the formation of half the normal number of segments, or the formation of segments that, for example, are all facing the wrong way. They have the opposite polarity. And so these very dramatic mutants affect the number or the orientation of the basic body modules. Again, the discovery of these just as mutants made molecular biologists, including myself, really want to know what these genes did. Such discrete effects on the number and type of body parts being formed. So the questions these mutants raise, they're questions really about normal development. How's the correct number of parts made? How are these parts put in the right place? How particularly do these dramatic genes work? Okay, so I'm gonna try to show this to you both a little bit. I'm sorry, but it's hot in Minnesota today, and it's a little hotter under these lights. And I wear blue jeans and a t-shirt every day. I'm not used to jackets and ties, okay? So I'm gonna show you both sort of in schematic form, but in real, with real images, sort of the logic of putting together a fruit fly. And what I want you to think about is I want you to think about embryos as globes, our globe, like the Earth. And what I'm showing you here on the left is a real picture of a frog embryo, which is a nice sphere. And I wanted to show you one nice sphere, because actually a fly embryo that I'm going to talk about is kind of a little flattened. But this oval you can still think of as a globe, okay? There's two sides to it. There's a full surface to it, maybe almost more like a sort of a football-shaped embryo. And if you look really carefully, if you see these little dimples all on the surface, those are individual cells. These are individual cells that you can see here as these discrete little structures on the surface. So at this time, there's about 6,000 cells in a fly embryo. And this is seen through an electron microscope. These are tiny, less than half a millimeter in size. But at this time, either with electron microscope or our naked eye, we really can't see a whole lot going on in this embryo. We're not seeing shape take place. But I'm about to show you all the action that sets up that future animal is actually taking place. Inside those cells, the chemical changes are taking place that lay out the organization of the future body. And what's happened is, through those mutants, we've gotten our hands on the genes. Through those genes, we've invented new tools to peer inside that embryo and see the complex visible be put together. So to play with this analogy a little bit, let's imagine an embryo as a globe. And if you want to know how to subdivide it into the right number of parts, or put the right part in the right place, it's really much like the longitude and latitude system that we have on our maps. So there's sort of a geography of an embryo. And you need to know where the head's going to be, where the tail's going to be, where the middle's going to be, the top's going to be, the bottom's going to be. And really, much like a longitude and latitude system, this is the early logic of building an animal. You've got to sort those sorts of things out. And what I want to show you is, both in schematic and in the action of these genes, the basic logic of that. So if I just draw a latitude grid on top of a frog and a fly embryo, the concept I want to give you is that body structures, tissues, cells, etc., are positioned by longitude and latitude, thinking about the surface, or actually altitude. There are structures that project away from the animal's body, for example, our limbs, or depth inside, the guts, the muscles, everything else inside. So really what the fly is setting up is this coordinate system that has all of these dimensions to it, and that the role of these genes is to specify these coordinates. And at particular coordinates, events happen for the building of body structures. So let's look in a little bit more deeply. The basic logic is, you have this whole embryo. Well, we can't specify right to the exact degree and the exact minute, starting from nothing, a particular position in the embryo. We have to work progressively from sort of larger regions down to very fine details, and that's the general logic. So the major axes, sort of the long axis of the embryo, if you want the east-west axis and the north-south axis, these are divided into progressively finer divisions over a period of time. And I'll just show you on the left here schematically our kind of hypothetical globe with its grid system, and a fly embryo here on the right. And the first step is really to divide the globe, the embryo, into western, middle, and eastern longitudes. And I'm just showing this in color-coded form. And that's really what happens. So the mutants that geneticists have obtained, when we got our hands on those genes and we said, how are those genes deployed? Where are they used in the developing embryo? This is what we see. This is a picture through a microscope using specially designed fluorescent probes that will light up under laser illumination. We're looking at two of these genes in action in real time in a fly embryo, when one gene is sort of marking out the western longitudes and another gene is marking out the middle longitudes. And there are other genes that mark out the eastern longitudes. I'm just showing you two for now. So that progressive subdivision is starting to roll. Now that's the east-west axis. Well, there's a top-bottom axis. Realize, of course, that animals have a top and a bottom, right? We have a back and we have a front, and our nerve cord, backbone goes up there and our stomach goes down here. Same thing in all animals. So you have to define what's going to be up and what's going to be down. So latitudes are divided into northern, middle, and southern latitudes. And I'm just going to show you how three genes are deployed. It's not important what their names are, but here you're looking, these embryos are tilted just a little bit so you can see them from each angle. Here's a gene that's expressed in the southern latitudes. Here's a gene that's expressed sort of in the middle latitudes. And here's a gene that's expressed in the northern latitudes, all at the same time. So what you're seeing is you're seeing the subdivision of the embryo into these sort of geographic units. Now, how do we actually start to generate modules? Well, the modules are not established right at their ultimate size initially. They, again, go through an intermediate progression. They're actually in a fruit fly embryo, first organized as double segments. And so what's happening is that every other subdivision along the major axis is being specified. And what will be actually every other segmental division is being specified. This was not obvious logic to us, but we have to learn what the animals tell us. And so I'm just schematizing this over here. And the idea is that this progressive, you start with something that's not periodic. Remember, to get this repetitive body organization, you have established periodic patterns somehow from an initial pattern that's not periodic at all. So you first subdivide things into large blocks. Those blocks will kind of be the rough subdivisions of the head, middle, and tail of the animal. And then you start to subdivide those blocks more finely. And I just want to show this in steps. And this all happens maybe 60 minutes in a fruit fly embryo. So you first specify these western, middle, and eastern zones. And then that cues another set of genes to subdivide this axis in double segment units. And that cues another set of genes to quickly. Now the embryo starts to undergo some movement, so it's a little confusing here. The actual body of the embryo curls over on itself. But what you see is these seven stripes are split into 14 stripes in the next step. And those 14 stripes are actually the 14 future segments of the animal. And What we see then is an aperiodic pattern becoming a periodic pattern and organizing the animal into these repeating modules in a very quick period of time. And what you're looking at in these pictures, actually, these are, again, pictures taken under a microscope to see fluorescence. These are the chemical changes taking place in cells before you actually see the physical process of making those segments and of making those modules. If you mutate any of these genes so they don't function, you have those very discrete abnormalities of, for example, all these segments missing, or every other segment missing, or every other segment having the, or every segment having the wrong polarity. So that's the logic. We have to build these basic modules. Now, I've told you about each axis, but for certain instructions, you want to integrate information along two axes, or maybe along also in terms of altitude or depth. And at certain intersections of longitude and latitude, the beginning really of new little worlds happens. And just shown this graphically, that while there's a whole coordinate system of the entire embryo, at certain positions, small groups of cells will be set aside, and they're going to form future body parts like appendages or organs. Now, they're going to be much bigger than the embryo even is at this time. And what happens is they themselves have these coordinate systems. There's a geography to every body part. And these things will grow enormously into their body parts. But they have a coordinate system sort of within a coordinate system. You're creating what we like to say is a world within a world. So in the fly embryo, that's saying at particular intersections of longitude and latitude, future body parts are being specified. And I'm going to show you a real-time example. This is one of these fluorescence pictures that allows you to see where the future wings and legs are going to be. So this little group of cells right here, if you count them up, maybe there's 20 little green dots. I'll show you in a second. That's going to be turned into 50,000 cells to make the wing of this bug. But it's first set aside at a particular and very reproducible position in the embryo as a small number of cells. And they're going to expand, and they're going to have their own little world within a world. These are where the legs are going to come from, and they're only starting out perhaps as 10 cells, these little purple cells that you're seeing here. This is the forewing, and this is going to be the tiny little hindwing of the insect. Now, there's something else you can appreciate. At the time I'm showing you this embryo, you may be able to see these grooves. The embryo is actually organized into segments at this time. But you'll notice that not only are the wings forming at a particular longitude and latitude, they're not forming anywhere along any of these other longitudes. And for example, the legs are not forming anywhere here in the eastern half of the embryo. And that's because superimposed upon this system, there's sets of genes that, again, mark out longitude and govern what can happen in particular modules. So the logic is you make the modules, and then you make the modules different from each other in building a complex animal like a fruit fly. And the genes that carry these instructions of what's going to happen in particular modules are those genes that I showed you on the first slide of the abnormal fruit flies. These genes are called homeotic genes. The term is not that important. It just denotes something that puts the right part in the wrong place. And what I'm showing you here in this color grid is the relationship between, there are 8 genes in the chromosomes of the fruit fly. And the color coding here is to show the body regions, both in the embryo and in the future adult, that each gene governs. So along the whole body axis, these 8 genes, actually in order of along the chromosome, govern what's going to happen in this body part, this body part, this body part, et cetera, down the axis. So particular genes affect what happens in particular regions. So the gene that was broken to give you a fly that had 4 wings, that was a gene that otherwise would be giving the instruction to make this segment different from the segment that bears a wing. So the homeotic genes mark longitudes along the main body axis, and they control the identity of segments and body parts. I just want to back up to show you when one of these body parts is growing that it itself has a longitude and latitude system. And I'm showing you this with, again, color codes that are showing you genes turning on in these cells. And this is going to be the front part of the wing. This is going to be the back part of the wing. And the green cells are going to be the top surface of the wing. And the yellow cells are all going to be the bottom surface of the wing. So you see really regular geometry sort of unfolding in the development of these animals under the control of a relatively small number of genes that are specifying coordinates in the body where things are going to happen. So, what should be probably eking into your mind at this moment, not only because it's a long day, but perhaps you weren't so fascinated about fruit flies when you came in here. So the story I tell is that many years ago when I decided to study fruit flies, my mentors, I was working in a medical school at the time, and the huge bias in medical schools, it's still there, is that, you know, you got to work on animals with fur if you're going to do anything relevant, you know, for human biology or for medicine. That was a very pervasive bias, so that when I told them I was going to work on fruit flies, they said, see you later. Never. And Pam mentioned, you know, various college degrees. Well, you know, Mom wasn't really thinking I was putting those degrees to good use when I told her I was going to use my PhD to go study fruit flies. So this bias was clearly there in biology, but what I've just shown you was a remarkable success that unfolded in a pretty short span of time, and at least understanding the logic of the organization of one type of animal, in this case an insect, a pretty complicated animal, and seeing these remarkable genes in action that makes tremendous sense how you would actually carve an animal out of a uniform ball of cells. But not everybody had that bias about furry animals. I do want to mention that some of the most important figures in evolutionary biology perhaps, so you had that bias, but they certainly had a bias about how different animals would be at least genetically different from each other. And this is a quote out of a very famous book by Ernst Mayr, Animal Species and Evolution, where the view, at least in 1963, was that much that had been learned about gene physiology at that time made it evident that the search for homologous genes is quite futile, except in very close relatives. The idea being that the more different two animals are from each other, the less they would have in common at the level of their genes. So that was certainly the bias, but some of the first researchers working on fruit fly genes decided to look around for counterparts of those homeotic genes anywhere in the animal kingdom. And they found them. They found them everywhere. I'll give you an example here. So I showed you a cluster of 8 genes that really govern the longitude system along the main body axis of a fruit fly, these homeotic genes that have dramatic effect on the development of those parts. Well, looking into the mouse genome, what was found was that there's 4 clusters of these genes, and I'm just showing you this as a genetic map, and this will make a little more sense in a second. They have 4 clusters of these genes, all linked together on 4 separate chromosomes, but certainly bunches of genes in clusters. And if you just, on a schematic of a mouse embryo, I'm showing you down here with a color code, look at how these genes are deployed. It's awfully reminiscent of that fruit fly, in that these genes are deployed, again, in order down the body axis in some way that relates to their order on the chromosome, and that they're expressed in discrete body regions that are going to become different parts of the animal. For example, these are the pattern of somites that are going to form ribs and musculature in the developing animal. So there are same genes in 2 vastly different animals. And if you look at how one of these genes is deployed in that animal, this is a chicken embryo, and this is its eye, this is the front. There are genes that are deployed, again, all at various longitudes down that body axis of a chicken embryo, as well as in developing body parts. This, for example, will be the wing of the chicken. So such disparate animals, as chickens, mice, and flies, have very similar genes involved in bodybuilding. I cannot overstate how this blew our minds. There is no biologist on the planet who predicted this. In fact, most of the bias was completely against it. So that discovery shook us up. At the same time, it was a tremendous window of opportunity. It said, oh my goodness, fruit flies, which had been a workhorse for 80 years for genetics, it meant that my work was relevant again. So I was back in good grace with Mom, but in addition to that, it said that animals that were harder to get at from a genetic point of view, like mice, like chickens, even like ourselves, that this would be an avenue in on their genomes, on their bodybuilding genes. We could rely on the fruit fly to teach us things that were generally true in other animals. Now, just to bring that home, this is these are pictures of a human abnormality in digit number, a condition called syndactyly. And this is actually due to a mutation in this gene right here, the human counterpart of this gene right here. So it's not only that these genes exist, but that mutations in these genes in ourselves disrupt the normal organization of the repetitive body parts of which we're constructed. So that was a big surprise. And what I want to emphasize is that if you look at this logic, you see that animals like a fruit fly embryo and animals like a mouse embryo have these sets of genes that are deployed along the main body axis and differentiate the various regions of the body one from another. Now, I'm going to get to in a little bit what this might mean in an even larger context, but that ability to compare animals at the level of genes and embryos opened up a whole new vista in evolutionary biology. And this is, in terms of my view, the birth of that discipline Pam talked about of Evo-Devo. So what is Evo-Devo, besides that retro punk band? I'll argue it's a critical element that wasn't there in the so-called modern synthesis. In the 1930s and 1940s, as Niles discussed yesterday, paleontologists, systematists, and geneticists found some common ground to synthesize a new picture of Darwinian evolution that incorporated heredity, incorporated genetics, to understand that what went on at the level of populations and species could account for larger scale patterns that we saw, for example, in the fossil record. And that really, in essence, was what the modern synthesis was about. But the modern synthesis had to treat embryology as a black box. There was no understanding at that time of the relationship between genes and form. No genes affecting the form, let alone the evolution of any animal, were in hand or there's any knowledge about them. So really what Evo-Devo is it's the science of how form evolves. And the great break, the fantastic and I think very deeply meaningful break we got, is that from this humble little fruit fly, we got a window on the whole animal kingdom because we found genes that were not restricted to the fruit fly in any sense. They weren't even restricted to insects. They're found throughout the animal kingdom and they shape those bodies. So those genes that mark longitude were a great start, but the surprises from Evo-Devo didn't stop there. And I want to mention a few more before I deal explicitly with the problem of diversity. Eyes have been a favorite topic in evolutionary discussion for a long time. Darwin agonized over the evolution of the eye because it was perceived as such a perfect structure. He wondered, you know, can people really buy natural selection as an explanation for the evolution of an eye? Now, you've heard this argument probably many times before. Darwin concluded, yes. Something people often forget when they bring up this story. Darwin said, yes, you can account for it by natural selection. But there are so many types of eyes in the animal kingdom that the general thinking among biologists is that eyes were a structure that had been invented many times independently, and because they had various optic principles and various architectures involved in light reception and in the behavior and physiology of these various animals. So for example, a squid eye was thought to be independently evolved from our eyes, and which had nothing to do, for example, with the compound eyes of a bug. And that view held for a long time was widely accepted. And with that view, work on the development of a fruit fly eye might not be expected to catch much notice. But let me show you some genetic results of the study of eye development, both in fruit flies and in mice. In Walter Gehring's lab at the University of Basel in Switzerland, they were studying a gene that when mutated, I'll show you down here, the mutant form, lacks the development of these really beautiful orange eyes that you see on fruit flies. And the fruit fly geneticists have this whole vocabulary. To me, it makes a lot of sense. Maybe you like it. The gene is called eyeless. I'm trying to avoid gene names, but let's just talk about eyeless. So we often name our genes by what happens when they're mutated. So if you mutate a gene necessary for making an eye, we call that the eyeless gene. There's a whole clever lexicon I'll get to in a second. Completely different researchers for completely different reasons, particularly because there are conditions in humans that are major defects in eye architecture. A syndrome called aniridia, which either reduces or eliminates the iris. The counterpart of that in mice, there's a mutation called small I, where these are various degrees of severity of the mutation. You can see that in this animal, for example, the development of the eye is completely eliminated. You can see the nose there, the snout of the mouse. But here in this mutant, this is the wild, the normal form. This is the mutant form. The eye is missing. Okay, so what? The so what is, this is the very same gene in fruit flies as in the mouse. The very same gene. So how can that be? That the compound eye of a fruit fly is under the control, the formation of that is under the control of the same gene that governs the development of the mouse eye, a completely different architecture. Again, chalk another one up for fruit fly biologists. This one blew people's minds just as much as the discovery of those homeotic genes. And just to show you a little more about these mouse genes, fly genes, let me show you some of the things this fly gene can do if you kind of put it through some exotic tricks. If you take this fly gene and instead of having it active in the head where it normally is to form this eye, you turn it on in other places in the body. If, for example, you turn it on other places of the head, you can see this red tissue forming, which are additional eye tissue. Here's a wing. So if you turn this gene on in the wing, you'll get an outgrowth out of the wing of eye tissue. You can see all this, I hope you can see the detail here of all this regularity of pigmented eye. Unit eyes all built up here on the wing. Here it is on a leg, sort of on the equivalent of the fly's kneecap. So this gene, it plays such an important role that when it's mutated, you get no eye. And if once you isolate that gene the way we do with gene cloning techniques and manipulate it, you can actually make eye tissue in other parts of the body. Now, if you take the mouse version of the same gene, what happens? Same thing. You don't induce the mouse eye on these fly tissues, you induce fly tissue, you induce fly eyes. So the point is that it's the context of where that gene is acting that determines what sort of structure is formed, but that the gene really is largely unchanged through the whole course of evolution since the split of these lineages way back in time. Fruit flies sit on another entire branch of the animal kingdom than do vertebrates, and we'll get to that a little bit in a second. Let me give you one more example. Here's another gene we've been studying in fruit flies. Again, one of these kind of nifty little names, not so nifty, called distalis. And this gene is named because when it's mutated, the distal or outer parts of limbs are all truncated. They're all missing. So you're sort of just left with nubs. So we realized that this gene was necessary to grow out body parts from the main body, particularly the mouth parts, antennae, legs, etc. So this gene was named distalis because you lack distal parts. Okay, two of my favorite names, though, a little aside. I'll tell you in a second, actually fruit flies have tiny little contractile tissues that are good hearts. And when a gene named Tin Man is mutated, it has no heart. There's also a gene that when mutated, the flies have no genitalia. All right, you high schoolers, there's a layup for you. But the name I love even most is named Ken and Barbie, okay? True story, I think that's just brilliant. So the deployment of this gene, I'm showing in a fruit fly here, and what these are the future appendages that are gonna stick out of the fruit fly. These are its legs. And actually, when I call these appendages, these are the mouth parts. And you may not realize this, but insects actually eat with what used to be limbs. They've modified limbs into these mouth parts. And that's the same thing in things like crustacea. This is a butterfly larva, very early caterpillar. And what you're seeing in purple is this gene being turned on in the developing limbs of the butterfly. And if you ever look carefully at a caterpillar, not only does it have limbs on its thoracic segments, three pairs of legs, its future six legs, but it has these nubby little legs on the back that helps hold it onto leaves and things like that. And those are also modified limbs, and they use this gene. This is a crustacean, and it uses this gene to make all of its appendages. But what we didn't expect, or anyone else would expect, is, for example, this is a fish fin, and it uses this family of genes to make the fin grow out into an appendage. This is a chicken wing, a developing chicken wing, and what you can see is at the edge of this developing wing, that little brown stripe If you could see it at very high magnification, you'd see rows of cells expressing this gene that are the outer edge of that appendage. This is a marine worm, even harder to interpret what this is, but all of these little dots are the so-called peripodia that are that flank the body of this animal, are involved in swimming in the water. And here's maybe the oddest one of all. This is a sea urchin, and these are the tube feet of a sea urchin and a echinoderm. Now, these animals represent really different groups in the animal kingdom. Yet, they all use this gene to make, I mean, these, the only thing these structures have in common is they stick out. They're just structures that project out of the main body. Now, is this an incredible coincidence that the same gene would be used to make all these structures? That just this happened at random? Well, here's your hint. No. It's a clue to something deeper. So now let me stitch together for you what I've told you about genes for eyes, and actually genes for limbs, and genes for making longitudes, etc. The best way to explain these similarities, as you've learned from hearing the previous talks, is that when we see characters, in this case, the use of a gene in building a structure, on different branches somewhere in the animal tree, the most reasonable interpretation is that the common ancestor of those groups had that gene, and perhaps had that gene serving some analogous role. But what do we know about the common ancestor of all of these animals, of crustacea and sea urchins and vertebrates, etc.? Well, that common ancestor is very deep in time. That's really the common ancestor of all bilaterally organized animals. So if we just set aside things like sponges and jellyfish for a bit, it's really most of the rest of the animal kingdom, these bilateral animals. So that common ancestor is very deep. And if I now put together information we have about that ancestor and what we can infer from what we've learned about what goes on in fruit flies and what goes on in vertebrates, is we know this thing was bilaterally symmetrical, and that's important in terms of the basic organization of the body. But now we know it must have had an extensive, what we call a toolkit, of these developmental genes, these bodybuilding genes, that controlled some anatomical features that had some degree of complexity. Now, how do we know anything about the complexity of this animal? How would we know anything about the anatomy of it? Well, part of this is inference, and part of this we'd lean on the fossil record, because the fossil record is the actual record of what existed at the time. Well, we infer, because all these animals branched off from each other, and good representatives of most of these phyla existed in the Cambrian explosion, that we think this animal, this ancestor, must have existed prior to the Cambrian explosion, which would be deeper than 544 million years. But it's really not known to paleontology. There's no critter we can point our finger at in the fossil record pre-Cambrian and say, that's it, that's the granddaddy of all bilateral animals. But what could we imagine about this animal then? And we can talk a little bit maybe towards the end. Part of the reason is that fossil record is tough, and most likely this is a pretty small animal, and we don't have a very rich fossil record for that time. Well, maybe that animal might have had primitive eyes or some kind of photoreceptive organ. That's what the genes governing eye formation would tell us. Something has been dedicated to building some light-sensing organ for a long time, and then used again and again in building all these various types of eyes throughout the animal kingdom. Now, I'm not talking eyes like a trilobite or eyes like us. No way. Something much simpler, just sensing light. Body outgrowths. Well, we, from the fossil record, there's no evidence of traces in the fossil record pre-Cambrian of animals with appendages that were getting around. They would leave tracks and burrows and things like that in sediments. So probably not limbs, but maybe something that grew out of the body, maybe some kind of tentacle used for grabbing food, or some sort of antennae involved in sensation at the front end of the animal that help it find its food or chemicals or whatever. It had some kind of contractile tissue to pump fluids inside the body. How do we know that? I didn't mention that that gene Tin Man I talked about has an exact set of counterparts in us. And when those genes are mutant, heart development in us is defective. So the same genes are involved in building our heart as building the simple little fruit fly heart. It was probably patterned along its main body axis, because we can infer it had a whole set of these genes for marking off longitudes along the body axis. It had a through gut, it had a central nervous system, and it may have been segmented. Fairly controversial, we're not sure, but it gives you a picture of some sort of animal that had some degree of anatomical complexity. And what I want to show you in this next slide, and it will take a little bit to get through it, but it's really important to set the stage, again, I think to set the context of where all these animals came from. A picture that's an integration of what we see from the fossil record and what we can now understand from studying the toolkits of genes and what we understand from comparing embryos. And what I want you to think about is that, and these numbers are somewhat rough because until the fossils are there, sort of the smoking guns, these are estimates, that perhaps 700 million years ago, the multicellular ancestor of all animals existed. And on this line, what branched off were probably sponges and cnidarians. Cnidarians include sea anemones, jellyfish, and corals. And then we got to something that we'll just dub the primitive ancestor of all bilateral animals, or Eddie DeRobertus is called Urbilateria. And what I'm showing you over here is this is just a sketch. I know it probably looks like that cootie toy that you can buy for kids. But it was an animal that had some degree of anatomical complexity, and it certainly had a full toolkit of genes capable of building a lot of anatomical complexity. It had a bunch of these longitude genes. It had genes that were already devoted towards building some kind of light sensing organ, already devoted towards building muscles, a central nervous system, et cetera, a through gut. Now, what's happening is that most likely at this early phase, the toolkit of genes I'm talking about, the bodybuilding genes, and when I talk about this toolkit, I'm talking about something that maybe in Urbilateria is on the order of about 100 genes out of perhaps 10,000 that are devoted to bodybuilding. The rest of the genes are devoted to metabolism and fighting off invaders and all sorts of things, you know, probably secreting slime and things like that. But genes devoted to bodybuilding had a toolkit of probably at least 100 or so of these genes. And that toolkit is a product of expansion that happened here on the early part of animal evolution. But in terms of anatomical complexity, the kind we think about, I think it's more productive to think about how anatomical complexity of more modern types of animals, trilobites and other sorts of things came about, the sorts of things we see in the Cambrian explosion, that was really ecologically driven, again, echoing what Dr. Eldridge had to say, that this animal was really potential. It had all the genetic potential. But the realization of that potential required the evolution of ecosystems, the evolution of interactions between animals. And what we see happening in the Cambrian, animals that are larger, predatory, have defensive skeletons, mineralized skeletons, that are clearly in some sort of arms race of prey and predator, that all that ecology is evolving in the Cambrian and driving the increased sort of complexity of animal anatomy. Better eyes. You know, camera-type eyes, compound eyes, more articulated limbs for swimming and grabbing prey and defense and walking along the sea bottom. So what we see, and these are sketches of Cambrian fossils at 505 million years or 515 million years ago. So these are pretty complicated animals, and they are bona fide vertebrates, bona fide arthropods, bona fide annelids that would be as good as anything else you would find out there today. But to see this complexity is really an ecologically driven, not a genetically driven phenomenon. The genes were in place. The genes come first, and it's ecology that has sculpted all these different body designs from this common toolkit. Okay, so anatomical complexity is increasing, and that's really a product of tapping into the potential of this toolkit. How did that happen? And that's what I want to address here in the last section of my talk. Now, if I've talked about this toolkit and you've grabbed some of the general things I've had to say, there's a paradox here. And the paradox here is that we know that flies, humans, and other very different animals share an extensive toolkit of bodybuilding genes. We know now from full genome sequences that mice and humans have virtually identical sets of about 29,000 genes. So you may have read those stories that people were initially shocked that, oh my goodness, humans don't have a whole lot more genes than anything else. In fact, they have really the same number as a mouse. Kind of humbling. Get used to it. Okay? We didn't have more genes. I wish I'd written down my prediction that we wouldn't. For what that's worth, maybe a Jeopardy question. I don't know. And you've probably heard the number thrown around that chimps and humans are greater than 90%, 98% identical to DNA sequence level. So the paradox is, if sets of genes are so widely shared, how do differences in form arise? So my argument is, if you've heard any part of this story before, if you picked up any of this in passing, this is usually where the magazine article or the Nova special or whatever, they end. We share genes with fruit flies. Oh my gosh, End of story, okay? But that doesn't explain the emergence of diversity. It just says we're operating with similar genes. It just kind of changes the angle we have to take on the question. So we know, in fact, from work we did in my lab, that if you look at all these Cambrian animals, by looking at their modern descendants, that all of these animals had essentially the same toolkit of genes. In fact, those longitude genes, same set in all of these groups. So all of this diversity, even in the early Cambrian, is evolving around a similar toolkit of genes. Yet we know those genes are devoted to making those body parts different. So how do you get diversity with the same set of genes? As you'll see, I have a fondness for finding my inspiration in the classical literature of rock and roll. So, if you happen to know Eric Clapton, he will tell you that it's in the way that you use it. So, it's not in the genes that these distinct genes these animals possess. It's in the way that they use it. And I want to illustrate for you, and this will take just a little bit of patience, just hang in there, the payoff's coming, that what I mean by differences in the time and place of gene usage that underlie differences in form. And I want to go back to my geography of the embryo analogy and explain that really the instructions for how, when and where genes are used are embedded in our DNA and in fruit fly DNA and other animal DNA. And they're embedded as little switches that sort of act like global positioning devices that interpret that positional information of longitude, latitude, altitude, and depth, and tell a gene where it can be on and off. And it's that switch machinery that we have to understand evolution. So this is your short, I know it's always daunting. This is your short, and believe me, I'm feeling as nervous as you are. Lesson in molecular genetics. But often the part that's overlooked, but it's really important, because if you want to know what makes you different than a chimpanzee, I'm going to tell you. How's that for a ridiculous claim, Tim, that I won't be able to back up? I'll tell you where we're going to have to look. I can't tell you what it is. I'll be honest about that. Your DNA, every organism's DNA, contains genes, the things we refer to as genes, but they also contain these things called switches, and I really want you to learn about switches as your last thing to take away from here. What we talk about at genes, we've been decoding genes for a long time. It's the whole backbone of the biotech industry, why we can give insulin to diabetics and growth hormone to people that need it and blood-forming proteins to people with anemia, et cetera. We've been decoding genes for almost 40 years. And when we talk about genes, and we talk about 29,000 genes in the human genome, we're talking about genes are the things that are decoded, and they're decoded into proteins. And these proteins actually do the work in your body. They break down food, they build tissues, they carry out defense, all this sort of thing. Proteins do all the work in our bodies. And basically we make 29,000 flavors of them to do everything that a human does. But to regulate all that labor, you have to have some control. You want these things to be working at the right time and in the right place, devoted in the right tissue. And the way that's done is that nearby, so while in the DNA, this DNA is decoded, shown here in blue, into a protein that will go do work. Nearby, there are switches, elegant little devices that interpret information that exists in cells according to their position in the animal and dictate that a gene involved in the development of the eye will be on in the eye and not anywhere else, or a gene involved in development of the wing will be on in the wing, or a gene devoted to the development of the leg. These switches are not, they don't encode anything. They are regulatory. They are off on. If you want, think of them as sort of light switches that are deciding what rooms in the house, what parts of the body are going to have these genes on. These switches are critical to the building of a complex animal because that's the orchestration you need to put the right body parts in the right place. And the mutants I showed you that had, for example, legs coming out of its head or the wrong number of wings were due to broken switches, not affected genes. The switches were broken. The switch was telling a gene that's involved in making a different part of the body, come on in the antenna. Wrong signal, wrong information. So busted switches are a problem for development, but switches are also the fundamental material of morphological evolution. This is how you can sculpt different forms using the same toolkit. These are the instructions. Okay, I'll show you a little bit how these instructions work, just to give you a little message. So genetic switches act like these GPS locators to determine where genes turn on and off. And the simple schematic I want to give you here is that in this DNA is the ability to integrate information, and I'm showing in this case from maybe three different sources. And these sources, these inputs, are deployed here in green, which is a go signal, and red, which are stop signals, in different parts of the developing embryo. And if you take these three inputs, you have a simple output, which is a stripe. And the way you get that is, if you were to sort of add up all the places that say where this gene could be on and the places where it cannot be on, what you're left with is a narrow strip of cells. That's how it works. Pieces of DNA integrate this information. They integrate complex inputs and make a simple output. Let me give you one more example. So if you're going to make, look down here at this pattern of these repeating little patches of cells, something like how you position a limb. Well, you have a go signal, if you can see these, all the way down the body axis at some repeating pattern. Actually, every module in the fruit fly embryo can make a leg or a wing. But what happens is instructions, stop signals essentially, are inputted into these switches that determine where you don't make those structures. So you don't make them anywhere in the southern part of the animal, and you don't make them anywhere in the east. And what's left, if you add all these up, is just six little patches where you're going to make those limbs. Okay? So switches are really important because they're the integrators of time and space in development, and they're also a fundamental material for making different types of animals. Let me show how that works. So, why are genetic switches important in evolution? Because gene patterns, the usage patterns of genes, and animal form evolve by changing the tuning of the switch. If you say, hey, you can't be on now in this region, if you actually shift the places where the gene can be on or off, you're going to change body anatomy. Or you can add or lose a switch. If you lose a switch, you lose a place where a gene might be used. If you add a switch, you create a whole new use of a gene. And this has been going on quite a bit in evolution. It's the way the same set of genes can be used to build all sorts of new structures, novelties in evolution. It's not that you invent new genes so often. You invent new switches to use genes in new places. I won't get into the third one. We need to move along. So let me give you two examples. One that's really about the changing the tuning of the switch, and one that's about adding switches, and talk about a couple favorite animals. And I want to do this to bring together sort of to understand deep history and how this information from developmental biology and genetics is changing even the way we look at distant events in the fossil record. One of my favorite examples here, and I'll bring you back to Williston's Law. So, you're familiar with flies and butterflies and beetles. In fact, there's beetles all over the place today. And those insects, like butterflies, have two sets of wings, or fruit flies, they have one set of wings. Those are all the insects you're used to. But that's not always the way it has been. In the fossil record, we have insects that have not only two pairs of wings, but something might be even a third set of wings or something like it off the more front part of its thorax. And then we have things like nymph forms, aquatic forms of immature insects that have wing-like structures projecting either from most or all segments of the body. Now this is an extinct form. And this is actually the history of the wing, another very, very important lesson in evolutionary biology being further illuminated by this evo-devo approach, which is actually we can trace the history of these structures because we can look at the history of the structure in all sorts of lineages where previously we really couldn't see the connections so well. These structures, which are the forerunners of wings, are actually respiratory structures in aquatic insects used for extracting oxygen from the water. Where did they come from? They actually come from respiratory structures in crustacea. It's virtually certain that insects evolved from crustacea. And that these respiratory structures, which are first used in aquatic forms, have been modified. And they've been modified in a sequence. Now remember what I told you about Williston's Law. Repetitive structures, and there's been a reduction in number and a specialization of function over the course of evolution. So here you have these respiratory structures all the way down the body axis. They've been reduced in some forms or completely eliminated to eventually now in modern forms. What you have are wings of terrestrial insects with none of these projections from any of the other body segments. So wings on butterflies and fruit flies have come, we can trace their lineage back actually into crustacea and probably deeper than that. And we can do that with different sets of tools that we never even imagined were going to exist. So how did this happen? The simplest way to think about it and the evidence we have that supports this is that if you think there's a, if you imagine now the wing-promoting gene, something necessary for making a wing that is in this form, active in all segments down the body, that as changes in the switches of that gene occur, such that it will now turn off at certain longitudes. Now this is the head to the tail organization of the animal. Okay, so up here towards the front, this animal is has lost its wings from the front segment. That's due to inputs in a switch. Then it loses these wing-like structures from the back. That's due to inputs in the same switch. So you're basically carving this pattern of wings out by excluding regions of the body, modules of the body. They're going to be able to form wings. So eventually, as these inputs have evolved, you've carved out insects with just two pairs or one pair of wings. And both the paleontology and a substantial body of developmental genetic evidence makes this a very reasonable scenario that fits for how the evolution of insect wing form and number has occurred over probably a course of more than 100 million years of arthropod evolution. So that's the idea of how you can carve a body pattern. Remember, all the genes are the same. What you're changing is only the switch. And the switch saying, where is this gene permitted to be on? This is a much better aerodynamic situation than this. So if you want to know what was driving that, it was the adaptation to flight on land. I'll give you one. What I also want to point out is that once you invented various structures, and there's tons of stories like this in evolutionary biology, that the evolution of a new form of life, a new way of living, or a new structure, in this case a wing for powered flight, opens up yet more opportunities. And in a group like the butterflies, this has served as an evolutionary canvas for the way this insect interacts in such an intense way with its environment, with predators, and with other butterflies, such that these wings have evolved perhaps 15,000 current different patterns. So not only have we carved a wing, but we've carved something new to play with. And butterflies and moths, but butterflies especially, have invented a whole color patterning scheme that is unrivaled elsewhere in the insect kingdom. So how did this happen? How can we even take these fantastic patterns of butterfly wings? How can we peer in and get any insights into how butterflies acquired this property and how different types of butterflies have evolved? How do we get in there? I just want to echo the sentiments of Henry Walter Bates. This is a quote from his only book, published just 4 years after The Origin of Species, and he absolutely delighted Darwin with this language. And that when he traveled down the River Amazons and saw places with perhaps 500, 600, 700 species of butterflies, he saw this and he saw the interactions among these butterflies and discovered some very important principles of predation and predator avoidance. That he saw on these expanded membranes, the wings, nature writes, as on a tablet, the story of the modifications of species. You know, scientists are much more emotional and passionate than you may appreciate. You know, you've seen a fair amount of good scientific poetry on these various quotes over the last few speakers. So there's Bates' take on that. How do we get into this? Well, I've told you, we know there's so much sharing of genes between animals that we simply took what we knew about fruit fly wings and we said, you know, we bet the butterfly is doing something with these wing genes from the fruit fly, the butterfly counterpart of those, and in order to carve these patterns. And just to show you the change in scale we're dealing with here, this is a real fruit fly walking across a butterfly wing. So obviously the whole animal fits on just a little portion of this pattern. And the pattern we wanted to focus on are these big eye spots. These are really important to predator avoidance in butterflies. And the way they generally work is that they draw the attention of predators away from the main body that's full of all its vital fluids, etc., to hit the wing. And the butterfly can take some bite damage out on the wings, a certain degree of it. After a certain while, the butterfly is pretty frayed. But it does distract the predators away from the main body. So eye spots are a very important predator avoidance mechanism. Where do eye spots come from? So we used our knowledge of how a fruit fly builds its wing, and we looked at the way those genes are used in butterflies. And we're back to a gene I've already introduced you to, this gene Distalus. And Distalus has acquired a whole new pattern of usage in butterflies that beautifully fits the development of eye spots. So if I show you, this is now showing in green, this is a growing butterfly wing in the caterpillar a week before that caterpillar will emerge from the chrysalis, form a pupa and emerge from the chrysalis. And if I show you what's happening, and this is a species from East Africa, this is the adult pattern, but as it gets a little bit bigger, you can perhaps start to see little patterns start to form here at the edge of the larger green pattern. And those patterns resolve into spots. And if you look at those spots under high magnification, every little green dot you're seeing there is a cell. And those cells are precisely positioned at what will be the white centers of these eye spots. And these are the cells that actually organize the development of the whole eye spot. They sort of act like a rock in a pond, in that they then influence the surrounding cells to form concentric rings of pattern around them. So what we found by simply following our hunch that genes would be reused in some novel way in butterflies is that we found the genes that are involved in making spots in a butterfly. And there are other genes we found that are involved in making those other rings of the spots. So these are the patterns of two other genes. I'm showing you a little from a little other angle, but I want to show you the correlation between the adult butterfly eye spot and these rings of deployment of these genes. So you can see that the pattern of expression of these genes, how these genes are turned on, correlates precisely with the future pattern of the butterfly eye spot. And it's that sort of, and every, if you want to just know, every little green dot here is a future scale on the butterfly wing. For example, would be one of those little gold scales or one of those little black scales. So in fine detail, this is a week before this pattern emerges. You're sort of painting the future pattern of the animal, first with genes in cells that all appear similar to each other, and then it emerges through a few more steps as the differentiated pattern we so admire in these animals. How did this happen? Butterfly eye spots evolved by adding switches. If you like, the takeaway is that new patterns evolve by teaching these old genes, genes that have been around for more than 500 million years, new tricks. How do they learn new tricks? Well, imagine in the distalis gene, and a point I did make earlier, is that an individual gene can have many switches. It can be used in many parts of the body at different times in development. So this distalis gene had switches that turned it on in the embryo where the limbs were going to form, turned it on in the developing legs, turned it on in the wing. But in the butterfly, it's added another switch, a switch that will turn it on in spots after all these functions are done with. So it's really an adding on to the butterfly development program late in development to sort of adorn these butterflies with these fancy color patterns. So adding new switches not only evolves new patterns, but of course it again opens up other opportunities for butterflies to further diversify. The distalis patterns and the spot patterns have been further modified in different species. So I'll show you, this is the species I showed you before, an East African butterfly with 7 spots on the wing and 7 spots of distalis expression that precisely foreshadow those 7 spots. Well, other butterflies, you probably know this, have different numbers of spots. Here's a butterfly with 2 spots, and it has 2 spots of distalis expression. How do you think this happens? Well, once you create a switch, you can play with that switch. So you can modify that switch so that it only has 2 spots, or modify that switch so it only you only get 4 spots, or even one of my favorites is modify that switch so that in different seasons, depending upon what the butterflies are experiencing, it will either make very tiny spots, which make it disappear better in the dry season, or very large spots, which serve well for predator avoidance in the wet season. So this is the same species at 2 different times of the year. And the development of those spots is under environmental control. So as you invent switches, you keep opening up opportunity and opening up opportunities. All right. That's good for butterflies and insects. And we were very, very pleased with this. I just want to share with you some anecdotes about what happened. I never foresaw this happening. Some of this work happened a few years ago. And I was away at a conference when all of a sudden I was being contacted by the New York Times and by various magazines. And I even got home and turned on PBS one night, and there was one of these essayists on the McNeil-Lehrer report going on for about 10 minutes, showing the cover of our article, talking about scientists discovering the keys to beauty and whether that's something that we should understand. And really, sort of one of these little disruptive episodes that Phil was talking about earlier. But it was fantastic. And I would tell you, should we understand more about beauty? Absolutely. This is where scientists find meaning in the study of life. As we look more, it's not that we are finding, as we make discoveries, that there's less and less to discover. There's more and more to discover. We get a window into how do you make spots on butterflies. It raises the question of how do you make different numbers of spots or different color schemes or how do you control them differently in different environments. It just continues to grow. The number of questions never narrows. Progress always leads to more doors, and that's what has us always fired up about this. We never feel we're getting near the end. We only feel that it's expanding. Absolutely, we should know more about beauty, because when you see this, in my view, it enhances the beauty that I see as the butterfly flies across the jungle. This view's not always shared. Attendant with press coverage, you get fan mail or non-fan mail. This was sent to me anonymously on a key punch card. I think it just said Sean Carroll, Madison, Wisconsin. And believe it or not, the post office can deliver mail with that little information. I can't seem to get my Christmas packages anywhere on time, but they can seem to get sort of harassing mail to me. But anyway, this person's view was that, you know, it's a shame that we brains can't get together to help solve the Earth's problems instead of using our God-given talents and our tax money to figure out the genes that color butterfly wings. Who cares? I have to hope that by now you care. Do something about our environment. Figure out why people can't live together in peace. Jack helped me on this. Even I figured this one out. Forget about God and forget about us, and this is what's happening now. Obviously, we feel different. We feel by understanding nature, only appreciation grows. But what can fruit flies and butterflies and insect wings, dinosaurs, tell us? And I just want to close off here and talk about what this field of Evo Devo can tell us about human evolution. Now, it's always phrased as, you know, what's the difference between a chimp and a human? On opening Sunday this year, I didn't see much difference. Okay, that's a nod to all you Viking fans, but believe me, it's tearing me up inside. So, there are a number of differences that interest us most, but all of these examples I've been telling you about, butterflies and insect wings, etc., what I want to leave you with is what's true for butterflies and other animals is true for us. When you look at the magnificent parade of hominids that Tim showed us this morning and you think about changes in skull shape, limb length, dentition, etc., this is the process of remodeling that goes on in bodies in the course of evolution. That remodeling is essentially using the same toolkit in different ways to organize anatomy in varying degrees of difference. And so if you think about the traits, and you can, this is just a grocery list, don't concentrate it on too much, that we might think about the physical differences between ourselves and chimps. All these things, either on the chimp lineage or on the human lineage or both, have certainly diverged. And somewhere, species diverge, we know, because of changes in DNA. Somewhere in our DNA are the positions that have changed in meaningful ways to make us functionally, anatomically, behaviorally, physiologically different from our common ancestor from chimps and of chimps themselves. So now, with the human genome in hand and with the chimpanzee genome being sequenced, biologists are out on a quest to try to find those genetic differences that have meant the most to the evolution of the characters that I, for example, list here, especially those physical and behavioral characters. What should we anticipate in that quest? Well, as Tim showed you today, these traits have evolved over millions of years and numerous speciation events. So if you look at this tree, this is sort of the hominid tree, various sorts of types. You heard the names of some of these species, and these red bars just denote the rough times that we think that they existed. Over here is the chimpanzee. There's been roughly 6 million years for lots of these traits to change, and they changed to varying degrees. Some of these changes we can see have happened cumulatively through these lineages, and we would, of course, dearly love to know what genes were involved. We'd really like to know the genetic history that makes us human and different from chimpanzees and other primates. But if you were a betting person, where would you bet? Those 29,000 genes that we're certain to share with the chimp, I'll go on the record with that, or those switches? I'm going to bet the switches. I'm going to bet it all on the switches. And I'm comfortable betting it all on the switches because if we just look at certain details, as we compare chimp and human anatomy, some of the things that it's a real long history in comparative neuroanatomy and paleoanthropology and things to try to find sort of the anatomical differences that might explain some of the big differences between our capabilities and those of other primates. But very often when you look, the templates for those important structures, for example, speech centers in our brain, those templates appear to be present in some form in apes. So human evolution is more a modification of degree rather than the invention of outright novelty. So we really have to see ourselves as remodeled apes, not something entirely different in design. So what does Evo Devo tell us about human evolution? It's what's true for butterflies and other animals is true for humans, and that the incremental evolution of anatomy is due to incremental changes during development in the size and shape and timing of structures. And these changes are regulatory in nature, and they're likely to involve the evolution of many gene switches assimilated over very long periods of time. We're not looking for a single gene where some magic mutation brought us out of caves and into civilization. It's going to be much more complicated. Complicated meaning messier than that. So be very dubious of any simple explanations of a single gene for speech or a single gene for intelligence or a single gene for a thumb or whatever it would be. That's just not the way it's going to work. It's a little bit messier than that. Evolution, certainly in the hominid lineage, is going to work in smaller increments, and it's going to work on lots of switches that have governed the different shape of our bodies, different length of our limbs, different sizes of our brains, things like that. And that makes it a great quest for geneticists because we've become a lot more sophisticated in how to tackle such complicated problems. But nonetheless, staring, it's going to be a tremendous temptation. We're going to have the human genome over here on one disk and a chimpanzee genome over there. And somewhere between those two are the smoking guns of human origins. And we really want to know that. So that's certainly going to be a puzzle for the next decade or two. So Darwin concluded the most famous book in biology by talking about a grandeur in his view of life, of how endless forms most beautiful and wonderful have been created and are being evolved. And what I hope you get a sense from this different take of evolutionary developmental biology, or Evo-Devo, is that by seeing how complexity arises from a single cell, seeing that process that happens every day in the lives of all species, how switches integrate this three-dimensional information to carve out a body from an initially homogeneous ball of cells, and how the modification or the creation of switches in the course of evolutionary time run by an ancient toolkit of genes has given us all these diverse forms, including us, that you understand our deep connection to all of animal history, and that what we're really looking at is we're peering back over more than 500 million years, and that in fact the whole animal kingdom is at least conceptually within our grasp of understanding where these wonderful forms have come from. Now, before I wrap up with one more feature, at least for my talk today, I want to thank a bunch of people, including especially my wife, Jamie, who helped me with a lot of these illustrations, and my stepson, Josh, who's far more gifted graphically than I ever will be, and two other artists in the lab, Leanne Olds and Steve Paddock. But I couldn't tell you this story without the contributions of many, many, many people in my lab, and I'm so grateful for Tim today to talk about the diverse, multi-talented teams that he's worked with to pull his story together. The same story applies in every branch of biology. Not only my laboratory, which has had perhaps 40 or 50 members over the last 10 years, but I, for some of these examples, I called upon work from various colleagues throughout the world of developmental biology and molecular genetics. It's truly a very large, multinational, very collegial, collaborative effort to solve these mysteries, and it's part of what makes our job so much fun is the people we work with and the people we meet in the course of time, including for me. I had not met most of these panel members, and I'm hoping to visit them in the Galapagos, in Alberta, in Ethiopia, etc. Okay, so with that, if you can start to roll the tape, I'm just going to drill home this lesson one more time, and you looked at a lot of static images, but I know that, you know, we humans, we like movies more than snapshots, so I'm just going to replay some of the themes of the talk a little bit in animated form and see if that helps you get a little better picture stitched together what I told you before. Thanks a lot. You've been a great audience.
Well, I know that many of you will need to be leaving here. But I would like to bring the panel up one last time for just a sort of an abbreviated question and answer. We'll the hardcore can remain for the final question and answer session here. And so